Thank you. I would ask those members who are leaving the chamber to please do so quickly and quietly, as we will now move on to the next item of business. And the next item of business is a debate in motion 12304 in the name of Jenny Gilruth on recommendations of the independent review of qualifications and assessments. And I would invite those members who would wish to speak in the debate, please press the request to speak button. I call on Cabinet Secretary Jenny Gilruth to speak to and to move the motion up to 11 minutes, please.
Presiding Officer, I'm pleased to open this afternoon's important debate on the recommendations of the Independent Review of Qualifications and Assessment. On Monday, I met with the Teaching Professional Associations to discuss qualifications reform, and I'm grateful for their input thus far. I look forward to continuing to learn from their members' expertise in that respect. Last week, I met with opposition spokespeople, and I very much hope that today we will be able to identify some areas of consensus on school reform. The Government will submit a formal response to the independent review in the coming weeks, and it is important that today's debate informs that process. There are areas of the independent review's report that are moving at pace, but we need to be mindful of the current context faced by our teachers and young people, as Pam Duncan-Glancy's amendment today makes clear. She also rightly points out the importance of engaging with parents and young people, and to that end, I was grateful for the opportunity to engage on this matter with the Children's Commissioner yesterday. That context has changed since the pandemic started. Fully engaging with the teaching profession in what comes next will be a guiding principle for me as Cabinet Secretary. That is why, Presiding Officer, I took the decision last year to pause legislative changes to the SQA and Education Scotland. And I did so because of my direct engagement with the profession, particularly reflecting on what I heard from Scotland's secondary teachers. I commissioned further survey evidence to strengthen teacher voice in the reform process, and I would like to thank the thousands of teachers that contributed, the results of which were published yesterday. The online survey response represents the views of over 9,000 educational professionals, the majority of whom are teachers. Overall, the survey demonstrates that there is no clear and settled view amongst Scotland's teachers. Now, while almost all respondents wish to see some change to qualifications and assessment, with some very supportive of the proposals, others favour a more incremental approach. And my view is that the survey succinctly captures that changing context in our classrooms post-COVID. Indeed, a number of factors, be those additional support needs, attendance, behaviour and relationships, or teacher workload, as highlighted in the Labour amendment, are compounding the challenge in our classrooms every day. So as Cabinet Secretary, I need to put in place a realistic programme of reform that takes into account the capacity of the system, as well as the budget within which we must operate. Happy to do so.
Pam Duncan-Glancy.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for taking that intervention. Does the Cabinet Secretary recognise that all of those circumstances have just been set out are reasons to reform rather than to delay it?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the member for her intervention. I think actually the context in which she's addressed is important. However, I think she will recognise I built in this additional year, and I think that has been important in the past year to capture teacher voice better in the reform process. I think that the system at the current time is dealing with a number of different pressures. And yes, reform offers us opportunities, but we need to be mindful of how that plays out in terms of the practicalities. And I want to come on to talk about some of that, particularly in relation to continuous assessment. So how that reform to curriculum, qualifications and assessment is advanced in that context, Presiding Officer, really requires to be understood, though I do think there is consensus in this Parliament that change must come. Crucially, reform needs to be interwoven with driving educational improvements. Now, in their most recent report, the International Council of Education Advisors reminded us of this, stating clear beneficial impacts on the learning and experience of young people and their teachers should be the acid test of any proposals. And I firmly agree with that. I would like to thank Professor Louise Hayward and her review group for the substantial report and recommendations on senior phase qualifications. And I know that some, though not all, are asking for significant change. The independent review makes 26 wide-ranging recommendations and challenges us to look at our senior phase qualifications offering differently. Now, central to the proposed new approach could be the creation of a Scottish Diploma of Achievement, comprising of three different elements. The first is programmes of learning, or subjects as they might be known in today's parlance. The review recommends that we change the balance of assessment away from that over-reliance on high-stakes exams, increasing the use of digital assessment and removing exams completely at National 5, usually taken in S4. The second is project-based learning, a formal opportunity to build skills and put knowledge through a project based on interdisciplinary learning. And the third is a personal pathway, an opportunity for young people to personalise their diploma by including a range of achievements that reflect their interests. Now, taken in their totality, the move to a Scottish diploma would represent a radical departure from our current qualifications offering. So any change to our qualification system requires to be managed carefully. And indeed, having been a teacher when Curriculum for Excellence was introduced, I know that there are lessons for the government to learn in that respect on how we can work better to support the profession on qualifications reform. As I announced to Parliament in December, Presiding Officer, a curriculum improvement cycle has already begun, with maths being the first area to be updated. Curriculum improvement in maths will look to work with the profession to better align the broad general education and the senior phase, ensuring smoother progression. And I'm pleased that we will shortly be able to appoint a maths specialist to lead on this work nationally. Indeed, that progression between the BGE and the senior phase should be seamless, but we know this is not always the case. Additionally, while the new qualifications body will consider the content of qualifications to ensure progression as part of the curriculum improvement cycle, the other change needed relates to rebalancing the assessment methods as recommended by Professor Hayward. And indeed, you would ideally like to do both at the same time, but clearly that's not always going to be possible if we are going to make progress at pace. Presiding Officer, not every qualification has to look the same in the future. Coursework requirements were reintroduced this academic year following the removal of modifications put in place during the pandemic. And whilst this was welcomed by some young people and teachers for some subjects, it has not been welcomed by all. I therefore ask the SQA to work with the teaching profession as part of their evaluation of 2024 to consider the experience of a return to full course assessment. And this might in the future inform future potential changes which don't have to wait for substantive qualifications reform. I've also had an assurance from the Chief Examiner at the SQA that they will consider the impact of the reintroduction of coursework in their approach to grading this year, which is right and proper. And that nuance is required in terms of external assessment weighting. I am firmly of the view that some subject areas would be better served by practical assessment. Now, how that might be administered in every subject area will involve engagement with subject specialists in our schools. But there should not be necessarily a requirement in the future that every single course needs a final exam per se. There are potential quick wins here, which I'm keen to see the new qualifications agency moving at pace on, working with the teaching profession. That partnership between our national bodies, local government, teachers and professional associations will be really critical to implementing reform. As Mr Kerr's amendment notes, this can't just be about our schools. Happy to do so.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful to the Cabinet Secretary giving way, and indeed she's postulating a fascinating thought. Does she have in her mind a time scale that we're looking at? Because certainly with regard to the maths specialist, really we're looking at implementation not in this academic year or possibly even the next academic year to see that narrowing. So does she have in her mind a timetable for these amendments to the different approaches to assessment?
Cabinet Secretary.
So there are two elements of that. The first is curriculum improvement. The curriculum improvement that I announced in December is going to have a maths specialist lead on it, and that report will work with the teaching profession and report later this year. So we will update the curriculum this year, maths followed by the English curriculum. We also need to, of course, engage with the new qualifications agency, which I will legislate for in the coming months, hopefully. And finally, of course, the government will submit its formal response in relation to Professor Hayward's recommendation setting out the timelines that the member speaks to. I think that is hugely important. But the point I was making, Presiding Officer, is that there are a number of actions we can take in the here and now to update the content of our courses. And I think it's important that teachers and our young people see progress to that end. Presiding Officer, we like tests in Scotland. As Professor Gordon Sobert has observed, in comparative terms, Scottish upper secondary school students are more frequently examined than those in other jurisdictions. And we should contrast the school exams approach with that adopted by our universities, for example, many of whom have moved to a much more flexible approach to continuous assessment post-pandemic. So why not our schools? Now, our teachers would say, and rightly so, that's because of the requirements stipulated by the SQA at the current time. But the role of the new qualifications body has to be central to a move away from that examination's heavy qualifications focus towards more continuous assessment. And how that requirement is implemented needs government to learn lessons from the introduction of the national qualifications. And Happy to do so.
Pundock and Clancy.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for taking the intervention. Can the Cabinet Secretary set out when she thinks the new qualification body will be up and running and which cohort of pupils will be taking exams that they will set?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think I gave some of the response to the member's colleague in the previous intervention, and of course I will legislate for the creation of the new qualifications body in the coming weeks, and we expect that to be operational from 2025. There were requirements, Presiding Officer, previously associated with the original approach to unit assessment, which accompanied the introduction of the current national qualifications. And this, I think, is really important. It's the bread and butter of what teachers do every day. But these standards were, in my opinion, accompanied by overly bureaucratic standards, which required to be overcome by every pupil, for every unit, for every teacher to input to the SQA. So how you administer continuous assessment really matters. We do not want a rerun of that box-ticking or overly administrative approaches, which add to teacher workload and do nothing to improve outcomes for our children and young people. Continuous assessment can support really good progression, and we know there are challenges right now between NAT 4 and NAT 5, and particularly that jump on to higher in certain subjects. So getting this right through curriculum improvement will support Scotland's teachers and also improve outcomes for Scotland's young people. Presiding Officer, the best part of being Education Secretary is undoubtedly having the opportunity to visit Scotland schools, and I'm always struck on my engagement in our secondaries by the extensive range of qualifications now on offer. For many, that move has been a really welcome one, opening up non-traditional pathways. But Professor Hayward's second substantive recommendation in relation to the number of qualifications we have in our school is in relation to a rationalisation of that offer. And my view is that a degree of rationalisation is needed to support clearer pathways for our young people and for the teachers working hard to support them. In that respect, I'm supportive of the review's proposal to rationalise the existing range of courses. Presiding Officer, I'm conscious of time. I've not yet had an opportunity to talk to the opportunities presented by project-based learning or in relation to, more broadly, how we can accredit the personal pathway element, although I look forward to hearing views from members on those other two elements that would accompany any move to a Scottish diploma. Undoubtedly, change must be carefully planned, and of course many teachers are now asking questions about the practicalities of how that might work in our classrooms. I think it was right and proper that we paused legislative reform last year to build in that opportunity for our teachers to fully engage with the report's proposals, because without them, reform cannot work. And I fully agree with Liam Kerr, who said earlier this month that it's the responsibility of Parliament to address the current challenges in the Scottish education system by setting them out clearly and trying to work on a cross-party way to find solutions. That's what I'm trying to do in respect to these recommendations on the independent review of qualifications and assessment. And I look forward to hearing the views of colleagues across the chamber this afternoon in advance of the formal Scottish Government response. Presiding Officer, I move the motion in my name.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I now call on Liam Kerr to speak to and to move Amendment 12304.2 up to 7 minutes, please, Mr Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I actually really welcome this debate on what has become known colloquially as the Hayward Review. Arguably, I actually think, and I think this is a point Ross Greer might pick up later, we should have more time on this in order that the overview that Cabinet Secretary has given, the overview that I'll give, can be picked up in more depth as we go through the afternoon. But also because, to quote the Commission on School Reform, since the pandemic, a veritable plethora of reports on education have been published. There's a lot of reviewing and report writing, but very little actual reforming. Now, I looked into that, and I discovered that just since the last election, in this space, there have been about 7 reviews or reports, 5 of which alone contain over 130 recommendations. There have been 15 ministerial statements, 38 Scottish Government groups who've met over 300 times, and over 300,000 words written. It's now 8 months since Hayward's publication, 9 since All Learners in Scotland Matter and Withers Fit for the Future, and nearly 2 years since the Muir report. And this matters because just last Monday, we read of warnings that the prolonged instability caused by the stalled reform programme was damaging staff morale and the delivery of services for teachers and pupils. And the real danger that I worry about is that the further we move from the 2021 OECD review of CFE and the pandemic, the greater the likelihood of reform stalling. And despite this barrage of reports and recommendations, and indeed the proposals outlined by the Cabinet Secretary there, and for example the Higher Education Minister in a very useful letter on Withers just yesterday, what I don't see is some overarching consideration which ensures that duplications in these reports, or perhaps the contradictions, are addressed, or that an overall strategy is in place asking what resources might be needed, particularly given the Cabinet Secretary's comments there on the various pressures that do need addressed and that will require resources. So I agree with the Cabinet Secretary, quick wins are good, but I just wonder what is in place to ensure that any such quick wins don't inadvertently prejudice other areas. And as Dr. Brown of the RSE warns, we do need to ensure that we learn from any mistakes that have been made in the past. My overall concern here is that, absent all of that, any reforms might not take teachers, staff and professionals along. So whilst the Hayward recommendations have received strong backing, some of the results of the consultation that was alluded to yesterday really are sobering. And as Andrea Bradley of the EIS has demanded, it is imperative that those who implement any reforms are listened to very carefully. And what those results from around 9,300 people tell us is that there's far from universal agreement with the Hayward recommendations. In particular, over half of responses disagreed with the recommendation to do away with external exams below higher levels, such that assessment would be internal only. They, and a significant number of commentators besides, raised concerns about the proposal, suggesting that removal could lead to pupils struggling with a transition to hires and beyond. And indeed, I recall Mike Corbett at the NASUWT last summer warning that it risks making exams in S6 incredibly high stakes in a context where there hasn't been meaningful practice. And questions have also been raised around standardisation and consistency of assessment, quality assurance, verification of what assessments count and how it might be cross-marked, and of course the perception, understanding and tolerance of employers. And the point about practice was one made by Professor Lindsay Patterson last year when he suggested exams help prepare pupils progressing to further or higher education. And this is a point made to me by several such providers, not only about the ability to set up new admissions procedures, the cost and time for them to implement that, but also the ability of certain institutions to move away from traditional methods of consideration. And of course, I also worry about the workload implications for teachers, particularly in the context of class sizes remaining greater than is desirable, if they're then going to have to take on an even greater burden of internal assessment. Now that, of course, is part of the proposed Scottish Diploma of Achievement, which is intended would transform the senior phase experience and consists of the three elements that the Cabinet Secretary set out in detail, the programmes of learning, personal pathway and project learning. There's a lot interesting in there, as the Cabinet Secretary set out, and we'll no doubt hear more as the afternoon progresses. But just to be clear, I've real concerns about the, of course, completely inadvertent, but definite possibility that bringing in a Scottish diploma with its inherent project learning and personal pathways based on assessed coursework could disadvantage pupils from lower socioeconomic backgrounds, given that, for example, pupils from more wealthier backgrounds will have greater access to things like extracurricular activities. Those in rural settings, looked after children, young carers, disabled pupils might also be similarly disadvantaged. And in a context where there's been little meaningful progress in closing the attainment gap, which we all know remains stubbornly high. 2 seconds, please, Mr. Greer. And the gaps in primary school writing and numeracy are higher than pre-pandemic levels. The last thing we can be doing is risk exacerbating that problem.
Ross Greer.
I'm grateful to Mr. Kerr for taking the intervention. I agree if we simply put the project learning onto an already unequal system, we'll increase that inequality. I'd be interested in his perspective, though, on the system we have at the moment, because the comparative data set we have from 2020 and 2021, where we didn't have high-stakes end-of-term exams, showed a narrower attainment gap than the traditional exam model. So clearly there's a level of inequality in the system as it stands, and I'd be interested in how he thinks we could reconcile that with a move towards more continuous assessment.
Liam Kerr.
Yeah, I think that's a really interesting point, actually, and key to that goes back to what I was talking about earlier, that we really need to interrogate what's going on here, interrogate the data, interrogate what happened several years ago and why we got the results that we did, and then interrogate the myriad reports that are around that to ensure precisely that, that we are getting the real learnings, the real in-depth, nuanced learnings from all of those to make sure that we come up with the right conclusion. So I think it's a very valid point, well made. Regrettably, Presiding Officer, I haven't time to talk at a slight tangent about the outstanding Foundation apprenticeship model which is being delivered by Aberdeenshire Council. I'd wanted to because it's demonstrating an awful lot of the things that are desired by this review, such as raising attainment and the attainment gap, developing the meta skills that we all want to see, employer engagement and rounded assessment and qualifications. But I'm hoping that to take up the Cabinet Secretary's offer, which I know she's sincere about, to work collaboratively on that going forward and hopefully bring what Shire Council are doing to the Chamber. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, the Hayward Review is a very important and stimulating report, but there are challenges to it. And what we must see coming from this report, from today's debate and all of the responses from the sector and yesterday's consultation report, is real, meaningful action. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Kerr. I think the amendment requires to be moved.
Move the amendment in my name.
Thank you, Mr. Kerr. I now call on Pam Duncan Glancy to speak to and to move Amendment 12304.1. Up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I move the amendment in my name. I'd like to start by thanking Professor Louise Hayward and her team and all the teachers, pupils, support staff and parents for the work they did on this. They and we have eagerly awaited next steps, and so I'm pleased the Cabinet Secretary has brought this debate today. But as well as discussing qualifications and assessments, it is important that we view them as one piece in the jigsaw and recognise how they fit with the many other reviews, consultations and surveys that have been carried out too. And so whilst they are not missing from the government motion, I do welcome the government mentioning them in their opening remarks. Presiding Officer, the case for change is compelling. Right now, things are not working as they should. For pupils, particularly those with additional support needs, for teachers and support staff who are burdened by heavy workloads, or for society which relies on the education system today, getting it right for the generation of children who will deliver the skills we need to grow the economy of tomorrow. A failure to implement commitments that could address some of the issues we see today, increased non-contact time, reduced class sizes and support for children with additional needs, has held back potential, caused a decline in pupil and parental engagement and driven people away from the teaching profession. So the Cabinet Secretary is right to recognise that things are difficult and that we need to take people with us and time to do that. But these are reasons to reform, not reasons to delay. One of the most pressing examples of why reform is crucial can be seen and heard in the experience of children with additional support needs. The scale of how badly they are being let down is coming over starkly in our committee inquiry. And it's not just about a lack of support. They are also being done a disservice in the way in which we attempt to measure their success. And so we have to change that. If we can get it right for them, we will and can get it right for every child. For too long, we've fostered a narrative by which the only way to be successful in education is to get high grades in academic assessment shown through performance in high-stakes exams. We need to change that, and that's why this debate is important and reform is pressing. The reform suggested, and particularly the programme element courses that are in there, and then assessment, is perhaps the most recognisable to what we have now. But this bit will need to come with significant reform too. A broadened, strengthened curriculum with a focus on knowledge and skills to grow the economy fit for the future. Significant attention to the recruitment and retention of school staff. And the ability for education institutions to innovate and deliver parity of esteem. Partnerships between schools and colleges that allow this and pupils to take college-level courses in place of hires and National Fives in subjects not otherwise included in the school curriculum, for example, engineering, catering or social care, should be supported and encouraged. Making these broader skills and courses available, and crucially by valuing them and by valuing colleges too, we can enable more young people to broaden their opportunities. Yes.
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank Pam Duncan Glancy for giving way. The point I was trying to make earlier on is that we currently have quite a cluttered approach to qualifications within the school sector. And I wonder if the member would reflect upon whether or not some of these subjects should always be delivered in school or whether or not there are other places in which they might better be supported, for example, in the college sector.
Pam Duncan Glancy.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. I think these opportunities need to be available to children and young people in Scotland wherever they are. So some children and young people will flourish in schools in these subjects and some will require a different environment, including, for example, college or elsewhere. So I think it needs to be considered specifically to the needs of the children and young people that are in our schools and education system today. I think this look at the curriculum is important because since the introduction of the Curriculum for Excellence, we have seen a narrowing of it. The 2+2+2 structure is still prevalent and means children are rushed to pick subjects they want to take forward to qualification as early as S3 so that there's more time to teach them and the relevant content to pass the high-stake exam. That culture of teaching to test stifles ability to develop deeper knowledge and understanding of the areas in which a child might excel or have an interest. It disengages pupils and it can limit their future choices and should be reformed. Allowing room to study more subjects is crucial, but so too is making the content within them fit for purpose and applicable in the modern world. For example, by clearly linking learning to future careers, like how maths can lead to a career in tech or gaming. And, Presiding Officer, reform needs to include a stronger focus on developing skills in problem-solving, oracy and cross-subject work too, so that young people head out to the world of work or further in higher education with the rounded skills they'll need. But to facilitate that broader learning, we will need to tackle staff workload, deliver increased non-contact time and address shortages in teachers, including in computing, STEM and in rural areas. And, Presiding Officer, the way in which we assess all of this should be reformed too. We must recognise the potential in all of our young people and to deliver what employers, colleges and unis need too. Assessment must benchmark talent. There is value in exams as they can act as a comparator within our system and to other places. But we should acknowledge that the uniform show of knowledge they demand doesn't work for everyone. Some children's talent will be demonstrated in other ways. Some will struggle to recite an answer on paper, but that doesn't mean they haven't taken in what they've learned. Reducing the weight and format of exams could help with this. So too could a changed approach to the way we talk about qualifications, the way we develop them, award them and accredit them, so that we can re-engage pupils through the delivery of parity of esteem and improve outcomes for all pupils, including pupils with ASN. So I also believe the government should accept the recommendations of Professor Kenmure to split the functions in the new bodies that replace the SQA and Education Scotland. I believe that doing this will be fundamental to meaningful reform. Recognising and valuing a young person's journey and unique talents is crucial to spread and foster opportunity, and the personal pathway in the diploma has the potential to do and value talent for all. But this approach must, as others have said, recognise that it is about valuing potential and removing barriers and guard against inequality. Well-off children shouldn't have an unfair advantage, and pupils with ASN should have access to the same extracurriculars as other children. And I believe we can do this if we measure success in schools differently, implement the Morgan Review, and by supporting youth work. Presiding Officer, what is clear that for so many reasons reform is needed, and it is urgent, because we should never pit one path against another. We should broaden opportunity and we should empower young people to take the path by which they excel and then empower schools and education authorities to set them on that path. Every child should face the world with no glass or class or stepped ceiling in their way, knowing they are valued and equipped with the knowledge and skills that can transcend barriers. We'll need to reform to do that, to meet the challenges of today and tomorrow. And colleagues, we need to do it quickly. Now we know what's needed. It's time to leave behind an era of review and usher in an era of implementation. Deliver the education system our young people need so that they can both enjoy and then create the opportunities of tomorrow. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Duncan Glancy. I now call on Willie Rennie. Up to 4 minutes, please.
I welcomed the constructive and open discussion last week with the Cabinet Secretary. I thought that was quite a helpful session. She was much more open than I was expecting her to be, which was a good thing. I have to say today, ridiculous to have a speech in 4 minutes to try and sum up what I think in this. We do need much longer to discuss these things, so I hope we get more time at a future opportunity. This is not year zero. 2016 wasn't even year zero. It was year zero way before that. And I think the education community have been expecting significant reform after the reviews that Liam Kerr, I thought, very meticulously set out. I pity the researcher who was tasked with working all that out, the number of committees that have existed, because there's lots and lots of them. But there have been various reviews, and there's an expectation being built up in the education community that change is going to come. So this sudden change of direction, and I think it is quite a sudden change of direction, I'll come on to explain what my views about that sudden change of direction is, but that sudden change, I think, has discombobulated the education sector. I think they are a bit confused as to exactly what's going to happen, and that's why this debate needs to give some clarity today. I have sympathy with the argument that there's enough going on. I accept that with behaviour, additional support needs, the high absence rates means that the sector is under, together with various other things, the sector is under a lot of pressure. And I have sympathy with that argument. And I think we need to be really careful about how we progress forward now. The problem with that is that there is an expectation, and she set it out, and her previous First Minister set it out, that by 2026 we're going to have improvement, educational improvement internationally, and we're going to be closing the poverty-related attainment gap, whether that's substantially or completely. So there's an expectation in the electorate that that's going to be done. So the problem with we've got enough going on argument is that that implies we're actually just going to stick with the status quo until we've got it under control. And so therefore we can't really just accept the status quo, we do need to have improvements. And the problem I have in particular with the behavioural issue, I just don't think, actually also with the absence policy that the Minister set out, I just don't think it's enough. I think we need to have leadership from the top explaining why we think the assessment on behaviour needs to change, and she knows that I'm in favour of setting clear boundaries and having consequences, or micro-consequences as some call them, so pupils know where they stand. And I think that is required in our schools, and teachers need to know that the Education Secretary has got their back when they take those steps. So we do need change. Before Christmas, I set out a number of changes that I thought should be included. On knowledge, I think she's moved now. I think on maths, I think that's a welcome step to increase the knowledge content, and I think that's really, really welcome. I think on resources, Pam Duncan glances set out the contact time. We do need progress on that. I'm not particularly confident that the Cabinet Secretary is going to be able to deliver it, but we do need it. I've talked about behaviour already. I do think we need to change the SNSAs. The standardised assessments for P1s are ridiculous. I think they should go. I think they undermine the curriculum for excellence approach that we've adopted, the kind of the broader approach to education. I think the accountability, the problem with delaying the reforms to the national bodies is we're leaving a vacuum. We need national bodies that have got heft and that are able to challenge the educational establishment. Now, I haven't even got on to Hayward. I'm going to quickly rattle through Hayward. I think on exams, I broadly accept where Carol Ford is and the Commission for School Reform in terms of NAT5s. I disagree with Pam Duncan Glancy. I think we should move back to the 222. I think that avoids the two-term dash. I have sympathy with changing the continuous assessments. I think the looking at reform of the number of qualifications we have is sensible. I do have concerns about introducing a personal pathway. I think the personal pathway is a big step, particularly how we're going to validate it. Project work, we could do more project work, not just the tokenistic stuff that some are implementing. And then parity of esteem, I think we should be using the SEQF framework much more explicitly. And I think we should be looking at the Insight programme, which drives much of the behaviour in schools in terms of what head teachers try and encourage pupils to participate in. And I haven't really dug into this. We need so much more time. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Rennie. As we move to the open debate, I would remind all members to check that they have, in fact, those who are wishing to speak, press the request to speak buttons. And I would also advise that members have backbench speeches of up to 4 minutes. And with that, I call Fulton McGregor to be followed by Sue Webber. Mr McGregor.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This SNP government has an excellent track record of investing in Scottish education, with significantly more teachers per pupil than Tory-led England or Labour-run Wales. And likewise, Scotland has more schools per pupil than Wales and in England also. Scotland has the highest level of school spend per pupil anywhere in the UK by £1,300 per pupil, and has shielded students from the extortionate financial burdens by abolishing tuition fees in 2007 and graduate endowment fees a year later. This has went some way... No, I've not got enough time for that. Sorry, Billy. This has went some way to reducing the poverty-related attainment gap, which is a massive issue in my constituency. And I want to say at the start of my speech here, I want to put in my thanks on record to all staff and pupils at schools across Coatbridge and Creyson for their ongoing hard work and commitment. Turning to the substance of today's motion, I welcome the final report of the independent review of qualifications and assessment, which was published last June, and the survey of the recommendations. The time for change is now. The question over reform has been around for some time, but the pandemic has certainly exacerbated the need for change. And I want to take just a couple of minutes to pay tribute to those young people whose education was severely disrupted during the pandemic in an unprecedented way. Because I think as that period becomes further and further in the past, it can become easier to forget the situation that unfolded for our young people. Children were off school for months over separate periods, learned online, were separated from friends. And although all this was necessary, and we all agree that, to stop the spread of the virus, the known and still unknown consequences on our children's learning and overall well-being of this could be extremely significant and can never be underestimated. And I believe that the Scottish Government does recognise this, and that's why I welcome, for example, the work the Cabinet Secretary has been undertaking on behaviour in schools, because there's no doubt to me, pardon me, and I'm sure others across the chamber, that there's been an increase in reported difficulty behaviours within schools in my caseload, and much of this, I feel, can be attributed to the pandemic period. I very much welcome the measures set out by the Minister today, including adopting the Scottish Diploma of Achievement as a graduation certificate for all senior phase educational settings, the end of exams in S4 and a wider range of assessment methods used in hires and advanced hires, and a digital profile for all learners, which allows students to record personal achievements and identify and plan future learning. I'm pleased about decisions around in-person exams and the direction we seem to be heading in, and I believe that this will be welcomed by young people across the country. Indeed, during a recent visit to St Andrews High School in Coatbridge, when speaking to the modern studies classes, I asked the pupils outright if they were for in-person exams or a continuous learning model, and it was an overwhelming majority for the latter. So it is good at last, I think, that we're appreciating the stress that the exam process can have on our young people. But, Presiding Officer, I think we all know that education is very much an interconnected tapestry, and we must strive to deliver real change in the round. And one area that I think we can achieve better outcomes longer term is through raising the school starting age and implementing a kindergarten phase for our young people. This, of course, is indeed SNP policy, and it's no secret that having a school starting age of 5 makes Scotland and the UK an outlier in an international sense. Yes, we need to be radical to do it and willing to invest in a future dividend, but the time to do it is now. The potential benefits could be substantial and help to tackle the growing issues of child and adolescent emotional and mental health, diagnoses of learning and behavioural difficulties, and the poverty-related attainment gap. Following leading up the Give Them Time campaign in here from a Parliament angle, at least, Presiding Officer, and my colleague CoCab Stewart's promotion to ministerial office, I am pleased to say that I'll be progressing this issue in this place, and I'll be meeting with the lead organisation Upstart and lodging a motion for members' business in the coming weeks, and I hope to have support from members across the chamber. Presiding Officer, to conclude, I welcome the report and today's motion, and I believe that we have got strong foundations to build on as we move forward. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms McGregor. I call Sue Webber to be followed by Ivan McKee. Ms Webber.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We can't afford to think that the Curriculum for Excellence, which was introduced in 2010-2011, will still be fit for purpose by the end of the century. And indeed, it's terrifying to think that those entering our early years provision now will still be working at the end of this century. Societal changes are happening at breakneck speeds, and digital evolution is at the very front of these changes. So thinking of the speed of technological evolution, I googled breakthroughs in 2010, and up came an article from Business Insider in December 2010 entitled, "What was the most groundbreaking invention of 2010? And number one, it was the iPad. And why was it groundbreaking? It said, the iPad is the first widely used touchscreen tablet, and according to one analyst, it is the fastest-selling non-phone gizmo in consumer electronics history. The iPad is so influential, clothes and bags are being customised to carry it easily. Larger than a cell phone and lighter than a laptop, the iPad is transforming the way people work on the go." We all know what happened to the iPad. And so much, and so like technology and society, things must move on rapidly, evolve and adapt. And that's why we on the Scottish Conservative benches understand and accept the need for education reform, and that this should be taking place at pace. What that reform might look like is very much up for discussion, And that's why having cross-party support for the premise to accept change is essential and a critical first step in the process. Because let's not forget that under the SNP government, education has gone backwards in international rankings. Scores in maths, science and reading are at an all-time low. Almost half of Scottish schools have not been inspected in 10 years. There's been a failure in making significant progress in closing the elusive attainment gap. Previous attempts by the SNP for an education bill were abandoned despite being called a flagship policy. Teacher numbers are down by over 1,000 since the SNP came to power. In 2007, there were 55,100 teachers. In 2023, there are now 54,033. And with the threat of more losses in Glasgow specifically, where teacher numbers are likely to reduce by over 400 in the next 3 years. The SNP have failed to deliver on the free school meals for all primary school children, despite promising to do so by August 2022. Entries in science subjects at higher level are at their lowest level in 5 years. So as I've stated previously, it's now a question of what reform might look like and the pace of change that this is implemented. We've heard that in the period just after the pandemic, if such a period can be defined as such, to be frank, there was a real significant appetite for change from those working in the profession. But now we're aware of widespread concerns highlighted by teachers surrounding some aspects of the review. For example, 57% of teachers disagree with scrapping the exams for S4 pupils. So we have to be careful. And it's imperative that the implementation of any of its recommendations be done in conjunction with teachers. But let's not forget the critical role of parents, pupils and other staff, with their voices being equally important when considering changes. This collaborative approach will ensure that reforms are not only well informed, but also reflective of the practical realities within classrooms across Scotland. We want to see urgent action to reverse the decline of Scottish education instead of more dithering and delay. And it's essential that the needs of pupils are prioritised throughout this process. We cannot follow a reform agenda that results in the status quo. Far too often, our young people in schools have been let down before. So I call for no more extensive and costly reviews. They lead to frustrating delays. Other countries are striving ahead with their education reform agenda, and it's time the SNP government got in the race. We cannot afford to let our children down. They are, after all, the future, and we have to equip them with the skills to face a rapidly evolving future that's ahead of us. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Webber. I now call Ivan McKee to be followed by Alec Rowley. Mr McKee.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Hugely important debate, and the importance of getting this right is critical, not just for our young people, learners in the wider, but also for wider economy and society. In the report itself, the Hayward Report, it mentions a reference to the World Economic Forum that identifies education systems globally are lagging behind the disruption that's taking place in economy and society, driven by technology and other factors. And we live in an increasingly competitive international economy. Countries across the globe are developing their education systems at depth and scale. This is great for economic development, but it makes it even more competitive. I think India produces about 2.5 million STEM graduates annually at the moment, and that's what we're competing against. Scotland's competitive advantage going forward will be building on our strong educational legacy to stay ahead of those trends and our competitors. It's a key issue for inward investment and for business growth. The availability of skills is the factor that inward investors identify most when they come to Scotland. Not how much money Scottish Enterprise gives them, not anything else that's going on. The great skills pipeline we have coming through our higher and further education system. So it's hugely important that that continues to keep us in that pole position. And what employers and businesses need is those meta skills, critical thinking, innovation, interpersonal skills, teamwork and much besides, but also critically, students coming through, young people coming through with knowledge as well. So the combination of both of those is absolutely critically important. Technology doesn't solve all problems. You can't Google everything. You need to understand the answers when they come back and how you apply them. And that is absolutely essential. And it's important that of course, builds on and supports the Curriculum for Excellence agenda. The review identifies the importance of project learning. It's a key part of the proposed Scottish Diploma of achievement. And it was welcome here that the Cabinet Secretary mentioned that even briefly in her opening remarks. That allows, that project work allows learners to develop those meta skills through work in areas that they have interest in. And it's also important that that, in many cases that were cited in the report, brings out entrepreneurial skills and project work that involves business start-up ideas. And I think this is where the work of this review it needs to be closely aligned with the work of the National Strategy for Economic Transformation in two aspects. First of all, round about the skills actions, which are one of the five pillars of NSET and the close alignment between this work and how NSET sees that taken forward into the economic space, but also round about our drive to create more entrepreneurial startups within Scotland and enthusing young people with the understanding that this is a very legitimate, worthwhile and encouraged career path for them to take forward. And I believe that those encouragement of meta skills and that project-based learning helps to draw that out amongst young people and highlight the link between that curriculum work and what they may choose to do in their future career path. I, as we all do, spend time visiting schools in my constituency and engaging with young people. And because of the work I've done previously as a minister and continue to do engaging with the business community, I go from that environment to talk to businesses who are in Scotland's tremendously world-leading growth sectors in space and life science and fintech, financial services and many, many others, advanced manufacturing and many others besides. And that link always strikes me as being somewhat challenged, the understanding within the school environment of what those opportunities are in the work environment, the very well-paid jobs and fulfilling careers that exist in those sectors of the future. And I think anything that can be done to ensure that the understanding amongst young people, their teachers and others in the school environment of where this, the changes to the curriculum can lead in terms of very worthwhile and profitable career opportunities is something that needs to be done. I know business is very keen to be part of that, that work. So in summary, I'm glad to see the government taking this work forward. I think it's hugely important my ask would be that they continue to engage with business and other employers, as I know did happen as part of the Hayward Review, as well, of course, with other others engaged in the education system, teachers, parents, pupils and staff. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. McKee. I now call Alec Rowley to be followed by Bill Kidd. Mr. Rowley.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In the short time I have, I would firstly want to welcome the fact that the Cabinet Secretary did call and consult with school and college teaching professions. I think that's absolutely right, and it's good. The proof of the pudding will be what views are then taken on board, of course, but I think it is the right approach. The Cabinet Secretary also said that reform must come alongside driving educational improvement, and I agree with that. And that must be also to address some of the issues that we have currently within our education system that have been widely published through the media and elsewhere. The response itself looked at short-term, medium-term and long-term priorities, although they, when you read it, they do come quite similarly. And the issues raised in the response, looking at reform, saying that it needs to be underpinned by adequate and sustained funding to increase teaching and support staff. And that, I think, is a major issue that we've seen come up over these last few months as education and the issues in education have been raised, particularly by teaching staff themselves through the many meetings that certainly I've had and I know the Cabinet Secretary's had. Teacher workload is a big issue that continually be raised when you speak to teachers or when you go into the meet with the trade unions. Support pupils with additional support needs. And I think I've said to the Cabinet Secretary before, where I've met with parents with additional support needs, they feel that getting it right for every child has not necessarily worked through the mainstream in the schools. But they make the point that if you want to get it right for every child by mainstreaming, you have to ensure that the support's there with kids, for kids with additional support needs. So there are big issues there that need to be addressed, and the curricular and technological resources. And sometimes, if you look at schools, in more prosperous areas, they've been able to raise lots of funds and they have the very best equipment, and you go into schools in the less prosperous areas and they don't have that same type of resource. So I think it is important. And I also want quickly to say, in terms of the point Willie Rennie raised about behaviour, I think we have to set out what's acceptable, what's not acceptable, and what the consequences are. And that's something that teachers are crying out for. Teachers say to me that it's not always clear that there will be consequences for poor behaviour. And while the Cabinet Secretary would quite rightly point out the majority of pupils in schools are generally well behaved and are getting on with things, all it needs is one child in a classroom to completely disrupt that class. So I really believe that we need to be much firmer and much clearer. I remember speaking to a teacher some months ago and I talked about the word discipline. I think I was referring to when I was at school and being disciplined. And the teacher made the point to me that they're not encouraged to use the word discipline in schools. You have to talk about positive outcome, positive behaviours. Let's be absolutely clear with kids. You're expected to be disciplined when you're in the school. You cannot disrupt the education of everyone else. And I think there has to be clear guidance given around that. The other point, briefly, I think, which I really do believe in, is this point where responses said that one of the most important recommendations respondents emphasised was the need for equal recognition of academic and vocational qualifications. I think that's absolutely correct. And for a lot of pupils at that point in their life, they may go on to do academic work later in life, but we have to ensure that route there for vocational education is, I think, improved and enhanced to compare it where it is now, but that's me out of time. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Rowley. I now call Bill Kidd to be followed by Ross Greer. Mr. Kidd.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I welcome the publication of It's Our Future, the final report of the Independent Review of Qualifications and Assessment, and I agree that it's crucial that the Scottish Government ensures a fair and credible qualifications and assessment system that enhances learning and teaching and creates improved outcomes for all young people. I also agree with the main thrust of the two amendments to today's motion, namely that teachers, parents and pupils need to be at the heart of any reform. And I sincerely believe that the Scottish Government has been and continues to be committed to ensuring that this is the case. In September 2022, the Scottish Government launched a national discussion, Let's Talk Education, where it invited all young people in Scotland from 3 to 18 to share their ideas, views and experiences around education. As part of the Let's Talk Education strategy, resources were developed to help promote discussion, and events took place all over Scotland, led by schools, community groups and third sector organisations. These discussions were, along with feedback from parents and carers and teachers, vital in shaping the recommendations contained in It's Our Future. Recommendations that will see the adoption of a Scottish Diploma of Achievement as a graduation certificate for all senior phase educational settings, an end of exams in S4 and a wider range of assessment methods used in hires and advanced hires, and a digital profile for all learners to allow them to record personal achievements and identify and plan future learning. These changes start in 2024, and again, I agree that these reforms must be taken forward with the voice of young people and teachers at their heart. I also agree with Professor Hayward, the other voice that plays a key role in education, one that is perhaps often overlooked, needs to be front and centre, and that is the voice of those involved in youth work. As the Professor said, reform means bringing together all of our resources in education and in youth work and in other areas to focus these and to make best use of each of the individual components to give every learner the best possible chance, and youth work has got to be a central part of that process. Molly McGoran, Chair of the Scottish Youth Parliament, also said, generally for young people, we are seeing that youth work has so much value in the education space, in poverty prevention and crime reduction. It's really central to everything young people can get out of, what they should be able to get out of their community. A national discussion carried out by YouthLink Scotland showed that 88% of respondents wanted the skills they learnt through youth work to be acknowledged alongside formal qualifications, and 87% felt young people should have access to youth work in school. I believe the value of youth work is clear, and I also believe that it needs to be further recognised and incorporated into any future reforms. In this respect, Presiding Officer, I'd be keen to hear from the Cabinet Secretary how we can include these voices on the journey, and equally keen to explore the issue further with the Education Committee colleagues as we shape the exciting further reforms into the future. Thank you.
Thank you. And I call Ross Greer to be followed by Ben McPherson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I've got a lot to cram into 4 minutes, but the Cabinet Secretary need not worry. I can write to her at length about this if required. I do agree with Liam Kerr and Willie Rennie, though, that we need to do this again with a full afternoon's debate once more, at least. The Greens have long argued against high stakes end-of-term exams and in favour of continuous assessment, because what we want to see is a rounded measurement of a student's knowledge and ability, not a snapshot of how they respond to specific circumstances and one that can be affected significantly by variables like illness. The pandemic gave us comparative data sets, which proved there is a problem here somewhere. In 2020, there were no exams. Grades were eventually issued on the basis of teachers' professional judgment. Attainment went up across the board, but the attainment of working class kids went up far more. The attainment gap narrowed. In 2021, no exams again, kind of quasi-internal exams in schools, though. The same effect, but to a lesser extent. Either normal exams are devaluing working class students, or teacher judgment is overestimating them. Now, I trust teacher judgment to a significant extent, but whatever side you come down on, that question does need answered as we go on with this process. Why is it that traditional high stakes end of term exam models result in such a wide attainment gap between those from the most and the least deprived backgrounds, whereas models which base grades on evidence generated through continuous assessment or teacher judgment result in a far narrower gap? The reality is our exam and assessment system hasn't changed since the Victorian era, but we know so much more about young people, about learning, about how to measure attainment and achievement than we did back then. In Scotland, we over-assess, and we often assess the wrong things. We're valuing what we measure here, not measuring what we value. And young people, colleges and universities and employers want more than that. Professor Hayward's recommendations are the opportunity to move from the 19th to the 21st century. I recognise the tension between the appetite for reform and the clear message from teachers that the current system isn't achieving what we want, with the sense also from teachers themselves primarily that they're already overwhelmed and that they would struggle with more change. We certainly can't increase teacher workload by adding more internal assessment responsibilities on top of existing ones, but we do need to break this impasse, and I'm glad the motion makes clear that the intention is to do so, to achieve significant reform in this Parliament. Young people themselves have made clear repeatedly through consultation that they overwhelmingly want these reforms, particularly the move to continuous assessment. We saw that in the review of the 2021 alternative certification model. A move away from external exams requires trusting teachers, though, the kind of trust that exists in other systems like in Finland. But Scottish teachers don't feel trusted by the SQA. Many feel that the standardised assessments indicate a lack of trust from the Scottish Government as well. There's a couple of specific issues that I'd like to run through that I think we need to address here. One's the external exams in all 3 years of the senior phase. Professor Stobart highlighted what an outlier that makes us, and it's a key reason why we are not really delivering CFE in the senior phase. We're teaching to the exam. The Greens would rather end external examination in S4, but we recognise the need to mitigate against qualifications without an external examination being seen as lesser, and we want to see a reduced role for exams across the senior phase. We also need to resolve the contradiction between the ability to choose up to 9 national fives, but each course requiring at least 140 hours. You can't timetable 9 times 140 in a school year. That speaks to a wider misalignment between the curriculum and the qualifications systems identified by the OECD, and that, in turn, is the result of a lack of cohesion between the SQA and Education Scotland. So the governance reforms need to address that, potentially by putting more strategic direction within the government's learning directorate. The Greens are very enthusiastic about Professor Hayward's recommendations, and I would urge the Cabinet Secretary to implement them pretty much in full. I have one caveat about the diploma. I think we need to make sure that those who do not get a diploma don't end up with the kind of stigma that we see in systems like the US, where there's a stigma around not graduating high school. There is a really important opportunity for employers in particular here with the personal pathway and project learning, which will recognise things like a potential candidate's teamworking skills, their leadership abilities, their communication skills, things that traditional subject qualifications don't give an indication of to an employer. Barely scratched the surface, presiding officer, but I recognise the need to round up here. So many more issues to touch on, but there's a high expectation that we achieve a lot with this reform process. There's a relatively high level of consensus, so we can't afford half measures. One clear lesson from the last reform to Curriculum for Excellence was that it was a mistake to only do half of it, to not reform qualifications at the same time. We can't do that again. We need to be brave and seize this opportunity to create a system which will serve young people in our society for decades.
Thank you. And I call Ben McPherson to be followed by Oliver Mundell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I will use my time today to emphasise some of what Professor Hayward has said. And firstly, I'd like to draw Parliament's attention to the evidence that we received at the Education Committee on the 20th of September last year. There, Professor Hayward, at the beginning of her evidence, made five key points, which I think are worth repeating. First, she said that the report offers a long-term direction of travel for qualifications and assessment in Scotland. She emphasised that this is not a quick fix. It is about thinking about the future and making sure that we have a future that serves every learner and Scotland as a nation as a whole. I think this is a really important point, which feeds into what the Cabinet Secretary said about taking the necessary time. Yes, moving at pace where it's possible and practical, but taking the necessary time to make sure that we get this reform right. Secondly, Professor Hayward emphasised that although the review is called the Hayward Review colloquially, it couldn't be further from the truth in her view in that she engaged across the country with a range of different stakeholders, and that the thinking and agreed positions in the report are from across all of those communities. And again, that lends itself to the emphasis that the government is giving to engaging with the profession and all other stakeholders, and it's great to see the party political consensus on that in the amendments proposed. That wide engagement going forward is so important in my view. Thirdly, Professor Hayward emphasised that vision is absolutely crucial. She was keen to really impress upon us at committee that if the vision isn't set, then there's a real danger through the years of implementation that we lose sight of where we're trying to get to collectively. And at that point, there's a process that will begin again of another review. So absolutely within the profession and within those stakeholders that are relevant to reform, we have to get the agreed vision as solidified and a collective place, as much of a collective place as possible. But I also think that applies to the political sphere. I think we will be able to serve our constituents better in this reform if we agree a position as much as possible and avoid party political attacks on this issue and focus on the national interest of getting reform right. Fourthly, Professor Hayward emphasised that the pace of putting ideas into practice should depend on the level of resourcing that is available. She stated that it's about working through the ideas and being realistic about the investment that can be made as they develop. And I think that's a really important point for us all to keep in mind in the context of the financial challenge that we face nationally. And fifthly, Professor Hayward said that, that there's no idea contained in her report that is not being already implemented in at least one other country. And I think that's really significant for us to keep in mind, that there's learning that we can take from other countries around the world as we engage on this reform. Two recommendations that I think could be quick wins in the time I have remaining. Firstly, recommendation 12 about artificial intelligence. It's emphasised that as a matter of urgency, the Scottish Government should convene and lead a cross-sector commission to develop a shared position on AI. If we don't get ahead of the AI revolution, we will fall behind economically, and also, of course, that applies in the education sector. We should have AI, learning to use AI as something in our curriculum across the board as soon as possible. And just secondly, recommendation 16, I think, is important. and obviously is an issue that teachers are raising with the government at this point. Lots more to talk about at a future debate, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, and I call Oliver Mundell to be followed by Claire Baker.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I've enjoyed listening to today's debate, but there's always got to be a little bit of balance inserted back into it. And the Cabinet Secretary groans, and I know that she won't want to listen to me, but she has committed to listening more widely. And I've spoken many times in this chamber on this subject and drawn on the words of Lindsay Paterson, but I think it would be wrong for his voice to be absent from this debate today. So I was going to start with a couple of quotes from setting out his thoughts on the Hayward Review. He says, "The review ought to be challenged rigorously and radically because it's deeply disappointing. Its methods were flawed and its recommendations vapid. It has a few good ideas, but they're not worked out in any detail and their practicality is doubtful. Implementing what is proposed would perpetuate the harm already inflicted by the implementation of Curriculum for Excellence, that two-decade-old reform which the present review extols as admirable." Now, I'm happy to acknowledge there are good things in this review, and it's a good opportunity for a conversation around how we move forward. But I do share concerns about how rigorous it's been around its starting point and the evidence base that it's built on. I worry that there hasn't, and a number of members have touched upon it, there hasn't been enough consideration of how these changes will impact on our most deprived communities, on young people who face the biggest challenges and barriers to education. And lots of the things sound good in the abstract when we talk about them here in this chamber, but like some other members, I do worry about the personal pathway. I worry about what that means for young people in my constituency who don't have after-school clubs to go to, who don't have access to exciting national programmes. Things like Duke of Edinburgh are not achievable or attainable for all young people at the moment. There are schools in my constituency where there are young people who would love to continue playing a musical instrument, but that opportunity and chance is not there for them and not properly supported. I think there are many young people who, again, have the aptitude and the ability to take on an interdisciplinary project, but maybe not at 15 and maybe not from the starting point that they're at. Certainly.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful to Oliver Mundell to give way, and I'm conscious of the time constraint. Does he agree with me, though, that that could potentially be where youth work can feed in exceptionally well to those groups of people and provide the support that they may not otherwise get?
Oliver Mundell.
I acknowledge that point, but if you look at youth work services, in my own patch, which are award-winning, very good, and I have huge admiration, they do not have the resource to deliver that kind of support. And I also do question whether or not it's a substitute for the teaching and academic support that those young people deserve, because they would flourish if that was there too. And I'm concerned that in some schools, in some parts of the country, in some quarters of our society, we say it's okay for some people to opt out of qualifications, to opt out of that formal academic learning, despite the fact they have the ability and the desire to take it forward. And we say these other things are the things for you. Don't worry that your child, don't worry, young person, that you don't have the qualifications you need to follow your dreams. We've found some other things that can go on part of your qualification to make up for it. So I think we've got to be very careful that we get the balance right and that we don't allow this to be a chance to write people off. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Claire Baker to be followed by Karen Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. While this debate focuses on the qualifications and assessment review, it is impossible to look at that in isolation. Reducing teacher numbers, increasing instances of violence and aggression, a drop in our PISA scores, declining school attendance, and the pandemic, it was highlighted by Fulton McGregor, the impact of this. These are just some of the challenges in education that provide the context for this debate. Reform to Scottish education needs to begin with addressing the outstanding issues.
Our young people deserve an education system which supports them to reach their full potential. Our teachers and school staff deserve an education system which recognises and values their dedication and hard work. The recommendations of the Hayward Review, which have been broadly agreed with, at this point lack the detail to make them workable. Without that detail, it's difficult to see them as achievable. And can there be any confidence in the sector that they will go ahead when we have seen review upon review over recent years without the Scottish Government enacting the form required? Looking at the findings of the school and college teacher consultation on the recommendations, it is perhaps unsurprising to find that there was such a range of issues that were deemed a priority by respondents, such as funding, qualifications assessment, clarity around reforms, that there was then little consensus on what the overall priority should be. Many respondents pointed to the importance of adequate and sustained funding. The success of any reform will be dependent on sufficient and long-term funding for staff and resources to deliver the proposed changes, and there are concerns that funding will be insufficient. Concerns that reflect the challenges of workload, resourcing and support that are affecting our schools, teachers and pupils right now. We need to see adequate and sustained funding to increase teaching and support staff, to address workload, to support pupils with ASN, to improve resources for subjects and schools, some of which the Cabinet Secretary and I heard from pupils at Newcastle Primary School on Monday this week. Without delivering the workforce support that will allow the professional teaching and learning development required for these reforms, they will not be achieved. The recommendations can be welcomed, but we also need them to be workable. A recurring theme in the responses was that they are too vague. There needs to be clarity on how assessment will be standardised if early stage examinations are reduced, and whether this will mean more work for individual teachers. There is potential here to develop online submission methods that could be used by pupils and teachers. That could present savings in terms of resources and also assessment costs, as it removes some of the need for physical locations for verification processes. But who will be responsible for project learning, and will there be national resources? Demonstrating commitment or achievement in extracurricular activities is something that employers recognise, but at present can be difficult to present to colleges or universities if you're not skilled at writing a personal statement. There are also challenges in ensuring those from lower socio-economic backgrounds are not further disadvantaged, which many MSPs have raised this afternoon, when it comes to project learning potential, which will require investment in delivering opportunities for extracurricular activities and the ability to record personal achievements. We know that some opportunities which previously existed, such as groups with an environmental focus, have been lost in some schools as a result of funding pressures and a lack of scope within the school staff for the additional work that is required. The recommendation for parity of esteem between academic, vocational, professional and technical qualifications is to be welcomed, but it will bring additional resourcing challenges that need to be recognised. In our schools right now, practical subjects like home economics are struggling to provide necessary resources for pupils, and in some schools are then being dropped as a subject for cost reasons. There are technology departments being told in January that there is no money left in the budget until the next financial year. Delivering these courses for pupils means properly resourcing them in all parts of the country. Since 2016, the Scottish Government has commissioned a series of reviews on various aspects of Scotland's education system, but has neglected to act on them. The outcomes of the Hayward Review present an opportunity for change, but we need more detail in terms of how they would work in practice. And if the Scottish Government is serious about taking them forward, it must, as its first step, address the current and significant challenges that our schools, pupils and teachers and staff face. Thank you.
Thank you. And I call Karen Adam, the final speaker in the open debate.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I welcome the opportunity to be able to speak to the It's Our Future report today, because I spend so much time thinking about the future of my children and grandchildren, all eight of whom who have made their way or currently making their way through the Scottish education system. This is a fully comprehensive report spanning 152 pages, but I wish to focus my remarks on elements which strike a personal chord with me, but which I know will also strike a chord with so many families across Scotland with whom I've had the privilege of working with throughout my time in politics. The points I wish to focus on are about how we can better support children and young people who have neurodiverse conditions, not just to get by, but to fully participate and thrive on their educational journeys. Recommendation 1, change qualifications and assessment in the senior phase in Scotland. is very welcome, and I note that the report notes that many learners spoken to as part of this review reported high levels of stress caused by the overt focus on examinations. I also agree with the report that change must be carefully planned and resourced. We know that stress and anxiety can often be one of the major aspects of having a neurodivergent condition. Supporting neurodivergent children in our education system demands a holistic and inclusive approach that not only recognises their unique ways of learning and interacting with the world, but also recognises their unique ways of showing and understanding of their learning. It's not about creating environments where their neurodiversity is not seen as a barrier. It's about, creating environments where their neurodiversity is seen, not seen as a barrier to success, but as a valuable perspective that enriches our whole system. Allowing for more long-term overviews of children and young people's educational progress, in my view, will result in a fairer picture of their progress. By fostering this inclusive approach, we can ensure that our education system is not merely inclusive by design, but empowering in practice, allowing neurodivergent children to flourish academically and socially without the pressure of what is to come. Assessments could be immersive and integrated into learning. Recommendation 7 states that all learners should be offered a broad range of courses, including academic, vocational, professional and technical courses. So ensuring that our children and young people are reaching their full potential and being able to do what they need to do to ensure that their needs are met. During my many interactions with children over the years and young people, from being a mother and a grandmother, but also I was a young women leader for a few years and also ran a local playgroup. And what's obvious when interacting with wide ranges and ages of young children from many different aspects of life, demographics, for example, is that one is no more less worthy than the other when showing abilities in either academia or vocational talents. And I welcome the report's remarks on parity of esteem for each pathway of learning. And on that point, Presiding Officer, I look forward next week to visiting local businesses in my constituency of Banffshire and Buchan Coast as part of Scottish Apprenticeship Week. These businesses are supporting many of our local young people through the valuable learning opportunity of apprenticeships. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, the aim should be for us to have young people leaving our education system in Scotland provided with tools to help them navigate their personal and professional lives. But more importantly, and this is vital, that they can look back on an experience that has had a positive impact on their lives. To do this, we must ensure that when building an education system or reforming one, that it should not be built to be modified, but built in an inclusive way from the foundations up. Thank you.
Thank you. We move to winding up speeches, and I call on Martin Whitfield, up to 6 minutes, please.
I'm very grateful, Presiding Officer. And indeed, it has been a fascinating afternoon of debate, and it is a great pleasure, as always, actually, to follow Karen Adam and her incredibly strong advocacy for our neurodivergent young people, because actually, if we can get it right for them, we will get it right for all of our young people. And actually, the processes that work best with our neurodivergent children are also the processes that allow children who are struggling with a strategy or a skill to develop it much quicker than just being lectured at from the front of the class, which happens so rarely now. But I think it is one of those standards that we should seek to look for, that the classrooms are welcoming to all of the young people who attend. And we know from the rising ASN numbers of children that this is an increasing dynamic that our classrooms face and our teachers face, and indeed other pupils face on a day-to-day basis. I was going to list the reports, but Liam Kerr did that, so I'll make reference to his report. It does allow me to nip in with the International Council of Education Advisers, which I know we will anticipate the response to their most recent report from the government in the near future. But it is worth pointing out their quote that the time for commissioning reviews is now over, which has been recognised, I think, across this chamber, and that there is a strong consensus about the need for action but the specifics remain to be determined. But we are concerned that the momentum of change might not match the appetite for change within the system. And indeed, I look forward to the responses to the six strategic areas. Because although come decision time we may have a disagreement with regard to votes, and perhaps this was a debate without a motion or a very short motion may have been an interesting strategy to pursue with this chamber. I think we have seen across this chamber ideas come forward, a great deal of consensus, which I know the government can build on, but also areas of concern. Because looking at the specific report that this afternoon's debate was about, it is one jigsaw piece in that, well, one part of the sewing in the tapestry of education that was used by one of the members. And I think it is important that a number of contributions have indicated the need to have a discussion about what is the vision that sits behind us. And I think the Cabinet Secretary, better than most, will recall the rollout of Curriculum for Excellence, where we went from a period of time of enormous enthusiasm amongst the education profession for change. They saw this as one of the great opportunities. But for whatever reason, systems that sit around our education just kept battering at it, just kept knocking it, just kept asking it to shift slightly, so that some of the real strengths of it that I think Ross Greer highlighted, some of the great strengths of Curriculum for Excellence has started to be lost. A number of members have commented on the shortage of time this afternoon. I think it's fitting that we have debates in this chamber where people struggle to get in and to contribute, because it shows the importance of what we are talking about. I think Willie Rennie's contribution about highlighting the SCQF framework that could be used more widely also speaks to the diploma and whether we have an opportunity, which we didn't have with Curriculum for Excellence, to redraw the language of how we assess, how we allow young people to show their ability. And I think it was a fascinating contribution, particularly from Ivan McKee, about the importance of that relationship that business should have and that perception that still exists, rightly or wrongly, about a misunderstanding between what the two different areas demand of each other. And I think this is an opportunity to bring those together. I think Ivan McKee's contribution about the meta-learning and the ability of project learning to facilitate that is very interesting. I think ties in with the report. And I think ties in with that demand of the tension between the meta skills and the personal knowledge that we need. Again, something that has been a tension within Curriculum for Excellence almost since day one, but will allow us to look and address that. And I think we have the opportunity to do it. I think Alex Rowley's contribution, again, about GERFEC and who is GERFEC applying to, and the fact that it boils down to resource, also speaks to the tension between the change that we need to see in the short term, which does require resource, sitting in this vision for the long term, and that we shouldn't take steps in the short term that damage our long-term vision. But without that vision, we are really challenged to do that. I'd like to thank Bill Kidd for his contribution with regard to youth work, because it did save me two more paragraphs of my speech. Because of the importance, as I intervened on, the importance and indeed the role that youth work should play towards some of our young people, particularly in the short term in relation to those that are challenged with their engagement. And I would echo his call to explore this further. I think Ross Greer's contribution was fascinating, because we have a tension about whether or not we trust teachers. I think when we had COVID, we had insight into what the potential of teacher assessment can be had, with a number of contributions about the insurance that perhaps people outside of the education environment need on that. But we also have to remember, and this again speaks to the challenge that CFE had, that strange piece of AI that suddenly reduced certain young people's grades depending on their postcode. And in summation, because I know time is tight, I'd like to thank Oliver Mundell. I think he was concerned that he was going to change the tone of the debate this afternoon, but I think, to be fair, he hasn't. I think he raised very important issues. And there is a tension between academic achievement and actually the young people. And I think one of the things that this Parliament can do is not to instruct, but indeed to debate what that tension should be. I'm grateful, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, and I call on Ros McCall, up to 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I thank every member who contributed to the debate this afternoon. It's a privilege to close the debate on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives, not least because it's a rare occurrence to be debating the substance when it comes to education of our young people. And I do agree with Willie Rennie and Ross Greer that our time today is unfortunately just a little too short. As my colleagues have highlighted, we understand the need for reform, and I think Sue Weber is absolutely right that when it comes to our education system in Scotland, we need to evolve and adapt at pace. We want to see urgent action to reverse the decline of Scottish education instead of ditherings and delays. But it's essential that the needs of pupils are prioritised throughout this process, and there has been too long a delay with review after review, and it's our pupils that are let down all too often. The need for a varied education offer and general acceptance that no one route is a singular route to success is a personal one for me. I think I've mentioned before that I didn't leave school to go to university. That route wasn't right for me. And at school, I find the whole process of learning in an overtly structured way very difficult. I had an aptitude towards function and discussion, so a positive destination for me was in management training scheme within what we called at that point in the 1980s big business. So I started at House of Fraser Stores. So it's been very interesting to listen to the debate this afternoon, and I'd like to begin by highlighting a couple of contributions from members across the chamber that I think are worth particular note. Pam Duncan-Glancy, I have to tell you straight up, I do like a jigsaw analogy, so thank you for that. But you also mentioned with Liam Kerr and Willie Rennie the amount of reviews that we have had and how important it is that they all actually work together to bring forward a really joined up strategy so that we can catch any duplication, as was mentioned by my colleague Liam Kerr. Also, Pam Duncan-Glancy mentioned the difficulty the current system has for ASN students, and that move forward with reform is now needed sooner rather than later, and I agree wholeheartedly with that. I also accept the Cabinet Secretary's comments to move to continuous assessment can't add to teacher workload. I accept that, but we must improve the outcomes for young people, and I highlight that comment. Willie Rennie is right to comment that expectations in the country are out there that we need to move forward, and these expectations have to be met. And he is also right to mention misbehaviour in our classrooms. Consequences, I would say, rather than discipline, are what we are needing, and that's something that we've been calling for on these benches for some time. Ivan McKee, I think, is very right to mention the important link to business growth and entrepreneurship, and that's something I'm also going to comment on. And I'm also going to highlight the comments from Oliver Mundell, because it is right from our colleague to raise concerns, because that's the whole point of debate, and how we make changes in this place that actually work for everyone. Presiding Officer, I know I have a short amount of time, but I would like to finish by raising the following points. When Professor Hayward, supported by an independent review group, including learners, teachers, employers, universities and colleges, published the report back in June last year, I have to be honest, I assumed that there was a level of buy-in to the recommendations, given the breadth of the review group, that I was actually surprised yesterday to read the level of disagreement to some of the proposals. The one that's a classic example is the Scottish Diploma for Achievement. 23.5% approval, but 38.2% disapproval of that recommendation. Personal Pathway had 23.5% approval, but 38.6% disapproval. And Project Learning, 16.8% approval, but 44% disapproval. And with 57.6% of respondents disagreeing with the proposal to reduce examinations, it highlights to me a worrying situation that perhaps the teachers that actually have to implement the changes and know the actual current position in our classrooms regarding getting a proper blend of educational options for our children and young people are not as comfortable with the recommendations that the independent review has highlighted. Now, I note that the motion calls for a need to make significant progress, agrees that these reforms must be taken forward with young people and teachers, and that changes clearly are understood by parents, carers, employers, further and higher education institutions. So given that assurance in the government's motion, I think it's imperative that concerns for almost 10,000 teachers and people working in the education process are taken into consideration. And I would urge the Scottish Government to listen to those trusted professionals working in Scotland schools on the adoption of any proposed new approaches. I would also like to mention the need for business contributions as a matter of urgency. As I say, it was already mentioned. It's so important that changes towards modular courses and practical education within our schools has to ensure that it opens doors for onward employment and positive destinations, rather than sending children and young people down an educational cul-de-sac. Too many times we find that employers resort back to examination results or further education certificates and degrees because they highlight an ability to work through a problem, a tenacity of character and a sustained work ethic that is essential for successful employment. But it's not the only qualities admired by businesses. So if we have the opportunity to truly reform, then including employers with the same gravitas as our colleges and university sectors, we will certainly find a greater buy-in and a more positive move towards the essential parity of esteem that so many of the teachers agreed with. And finally, Presiding Officer, I would really like to know more about the next steps. The final page of the report mentions the debate today, and I accept that. But we don't have a lot of detail, and I am really looking forward to the formal response when it comes on how the government's plans to take forward these reviews, and I know that is coming. But in particular, this review, considering the percentage of teachers that are not in agreement with the initial recommendations, I think that has to be part of the way forward. Like so many things, how implementation progresses is paramount to success. So it's time for action. Our children, young people, employers, colleges and universities deserve nothing less. Thank you.
Thank you, and I call on Jenny Gilruth to wind up to 9 minutes, Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, a key theme in this afternoon's debate has been time, and I recognise that this afternoon's debate has been truncated because of other parliamentary business. So I want to first of all recognise that and put on the record my commitment to come back to Parliament to have a further, fuller debate, perhaps after the publication of the Government's formal response to the review as was outlined previously. And I also want to commit to engage with the opposition more generally, out with the Chamber, with my officials, as we did last week, because I think that will help to inform the process as we move forward. I think we do have a great deal of consensus in the Parliament on education reform, to Martin Whitfield's point, and I'm really keen to solidify that opportunity more formally and more regularly. He also spoke about the tensions, of course, with the introduction of Curriculum for Excellence. I hope he still has a copy of his green folder, as I do. But I well understand some of the challenge that inherently is attached to educational reform. And I think we need to be mindful of the potential pitfalls to that end, as I outlined in my opening contribution today, Presiding Officer. I want to respond to some of the comments from members and what I thought was a really positive and helpful debate, and at times undoubtedly there was challenge. I have to say I really welcome the challenge from Oliver Mundell. I agree with many of the points he made in relation to project-based learning, but also in broader achievement and how on earth that might be accredited in the future. I think we need to be really mindful in relation to equity issues, and that has been a challenge. I think it was discussed by the group in the approach that has been taken by Professor Hayward throughout the review. Liam Kerr rightly notes, though, that there is room for different views within relation to the recommendations. He spoke about the government survey, and I think it's important to reflect the range of different views that are out there. That challenge, I think, from the profession has been reflected to us because the profession will always think about the practicalities of enacting reform and what it means in their classrooms. And we need to ensure that our teachers are part of this process, but we also need to listen to them, which is exactly why, Presiding Officer, I built in this additionality to give teachers the opportunity to contribute and to us, for us in government, to hear their views and better reflect that in the formal response. Mr Kerr touched on, I think, apprenticeships in his region. I'd be more than happy to engage on a visit with him if that was the offer, to look at the work being done by DYW in his area, or indeed Mr Day may wish to take up that kind offer. He also spoke, I think, about some of the inequity issues that were touched on by Oliver Mundell, and I do think we need to be mindful in that approach, particularly in relation to the personal pathway element. Now, Pam Duncan-Glancy spoke about the compelling case for change. And I suppose I hear two views on that. I hear one really strong, compelling case for change, and I hear another view from the teaching profession in the survey that we've published yesterday, which is be mindful of the current challenge in the system. So these two things need to be balanced. However, I think we have built in that additionality in the previous year, and now is the time to move forward. Ms Duncan Glancy also spoke of the importance in relation to splitting the inspectorate function from Education Scotland, and of course I will bring forward legislation to that end later this year on that specific point. I do think, though, to Willie Rennie's points in relation to the national agencies, there's a real opportunity to ensure that Education Scotland works better and more closely alongside the teaching profession to provide that support where it's needed. Happy to do so.
Pam Duncan Glancy.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for taking that intervention. Forgive me, she'd moved on slightly to Willie Rennie's point. On the splitting of the functions, do you also accept, does the Cabinet Secretary also accept that it is important to split the accreditation and awarding function from the new qualifications body?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think Ms Duncan Glancy knows that the Government does not support that approach, and I think that's been outlined in our approach thus far. However, I look forward to engaging with her on the substantives of the legislation when that comes forward in due course. I was reflecting recently on the role of school in that regard, though, more generally post-COVID, and evidence from the Centre for Social Justice, which talks to the fraying link between home and school post-COVID. And I think it is important that we reset that relationship with the school and with our parents, particularly in relation to the reform of the qualifications system. There was a discussion around about the range of different qualifications, I think, in Ms Duncan Glancy's contribution too. And the point I was making in my initial remarks, Presiding Officer, was that that plethora of different qualifications which currently exist in the senior phase can be confusing for many young people, and I think we need to have a decluttering of that offer and a rationalisation, which is one of the key recommendations from Professor Hayward's review, to ensure that our young people can see those pathways more clearly and identify opportunities accordingly. Now, Willie Rennie spoke undoubtedly about the pressure in the system at the current time, which I absolutely accept. I agree with him, the status quo cannot hold. I think this last year has been important to capture teacher views and to have that contrasting view, actually, in relation to some of the recommendations. The words that I used, of course, in the Chamber, actually, before Christmas, were that the status quo cannot hold. So that was in relation to the challenge presented to the Government in relation to the PISA statistics, but I think more generally we need to now move forward. It was interesting to hear Mr Rennie's views regarding the 222 model. It's taken me back to my time on the Education Committee in the previous Parliament, where, of course, we debated this very issue at length with Ms Duncan Glancy's predecessor, who I think might have had a different view. And Mr Mundell might remember some of those conversations too around about subject choice. And what that really talks to are the practicalities of how you timetable curriculum change. And we need to be mindful of what this means for our teachers. I do think that's why there is a degree of hesitance within the profession at the current time, because they are always thinking about how these things will work in practice in the classroom. Happy to do so.
Willie Rennie.
Does she think that the inconsistency from one school to another, different local authorities, on that split is adding to the difficulties of making sure that we raise standards throughout?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think undoubtedly there are different approaches, and one of the key strengths, of course, of Curriculum for Excellence was that it was meant to be a system that allowed for local decision making in local schools. But I think if he's asking for the Government to give more of a direction on how many subjects the school should teach, then perhaps we should have a further debate on that issue. I do think more generally we need to reflect that there are inequities across the system at the current time in terms of those entitlements. That language of entitlements that Professor Hayward uses in the report is a really interesting one, because we know there's variance across the system at the current time. So perhaps we do need to give more firm guidance in that. I don't think it would be my role as Cabinet Secretary to provide that direction to schools, but I do think we need to think about how Education Scotland could help to support a more equal system across the board, because this is fundamentally about the entitlements of our young people and ensuring they all have access to the full suite of qualifications that Pam Duncan Glancy spoke to. Presiding Officer, I'm conscious of time. Ivan McKee spoke about the importance of meta-skills and knowledge for employers, and I think this was touched on by a number of other members this afternoon. That's been one of the really key drivers behind curriculum improvement, actually, to ensure the role of knowledge is better reflected. And actually, although Mr Mundell might think that I don't listen to Lindsay Paterson, I agree more broadly with him on the point in relation to knowledge within the curriculum, which is why, of course, we're taking forward this work on curriculum improvement. I think more generally, though, the points that were made by Ros McCall in relation to the involvement of business and how we can use business expertise to help inform our educational offer is really important. Business, as we heard from Mr McKee, have a key role to play in relation to qualifications reform. They will have many views in relation to our current offer, I know this, and that's why, of course, we need to have a coherent offer, and that's been part, I think, of some of the key messages coming from this afternoon's debate. Ross Grier cut really to the heart of the challenge in relation to continuous assessment and high-stakes examinations, which we do continue to have a reliance on in Scotland at the current time, unlike many other countries, I should say so. And I think we heard from Karen Adam about the stress that can create for our young people. But we should also reflect on the stress it creates for our teachers. And I mentioned in my initial contribution, Presiding Officer, the reintroduction of some of the qualifications requirements this year that I know at the current time are creating pressure in the system, which is why I've asked the SQA to review those arrangements, to be mindful of those arrangements this year, but also to take that into consideration in relation to the grading approach that will be used in this year's examinations too. Presiding Officer, I hear the challenge from Mr Mundell and others around about specifically project-based learning and those programmes of learning, and I'm very live to those issues. But I have outlined today where we are able to make progress and where we have been able to move forward at pace, and that is really specifically in relation to the qualifications themselves, Presiding Officer, which I think is important and allows us to identify opportunities whilst working with the profession. The pandemic undoubtedly was an extraordinary time in all of our lives. Our children lived through that period and they also had their education turned upside down. Our teachers stepped up, moving at pace to respond to a global emergency. Now is the time, Presiding Officer, to recast our educational offer, to ensure it's fit for purpose for Scotland's children and young people, to best equip them for life after school or whichever pathway they see fit to follow, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on recommendations of the Independent Review of Qualifications and Assessment. It's now time to move on to the next item of business, which is consideration of Bureau Motion 12320 in the name of George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau setting out a business programme. And I call on George Adam to move the motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm moved.
Thank you, Minister. No member has asked to speak on the motion. Therefore, the question is that motion 12320 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. The next item of business is consideration of business motion 12321 in the name of George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau on a Stage 1 extension. Any member who wishes to speak against the motion should press their request to speak button now. And I call on George Adam to move the motion.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I'm moved.
Thank you, Minister. No member has asked to speak against the motion. Therefore, the question is that motion 12321 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. And the next item of business is consideration of three Parliamentary Bureau motions. And I ask George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau to move motions 12322 to 12324 on approval of SSIs.
All three moved, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Minister. The question on these motions will be put at decision time, and there are seven questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first is that motion 12130, in the name of Tom Arthur, on Local Government Finance Scotland Order 2024 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The Parliament is not agreed, therefore we'll move to a vote and there'll be a short suspension to allow members to access the digital voting system.